Today, I'm specifically going to talk a little bit about the women in the movement, but I want to focus more especially on Amy Jakes Garvey. Now, the reason for that is, without her, much of what we know about Garvey would have probably been pushed to one side. She spent, after Garvey's death in 1940, she spent the remainder of her life raising their two children, which I'll mention during the presentation, but also in ensuring that Garvey's legacy was not forgotten. And through her speeches, through her meetings with students, Garvey scholars, etc., as you'll hear from the presentation, it is because of her why we are all able to shout, Garvey lives, and to have that information in Philosophies 1, 2, and Volume 3 of Garvey, of Garvey's philosophy and opinions, because the third copy she was working on, but she actually died prior to it being completed. And one of our warriors from Nigeria actually co-worked with her and published the volume 3 of Philosophy and Opinions of Marcus Garvey, which is why we have that book. And I'm gonna mention some of her books that she actually produced, but just to start by saying, my name, as you've heard, is Nzingha Assata. I'm author of the book Women in the Garvey Movement, which was published in 2008. I've also, in 2014, created the poster about the Women in the Garvey Movement. Now, I'm not just here to sell you these. I'd love you to buy a copy. The posters are £5, and the book is £10. Basically, the book highlights the women that we actually know about, but also reproduces a number of essays written by Mrs. Amy Jakes Garvey herself. She was editor of the women's page of the Negro World newspaper. So that's just so you know they're there, you have the opportunity to access those. So we're going to talk a bit about the women in the Garvey movement. Before I go on, I want to just mention these books for you, because often when meetings finish, people rush off and they often don't get a chance to hear about the books that are available, because I think it's really important not always just to come and listen, but to read for yourself so that you can form your own opinion as to how things are and what is important to you. And perhaps it can then inform whatever work you decide you would like to do within the community. So in the Marcus Garvey centenary copy of the Jamaica Journal, now this was produced in 1987, when I was a member of the Garvey Centenary Committee and I attended the conference in Jamaica. And this booklet highlights Garvey's work in different aspects of his legacy, but also has an article about his first wife and also his second wife. So, I mean, things like these now you can access online. So this was produced by the Institute of Jamaica. I've mentioned my book already. There's a book that actually outlines the life and times of Amy Jakes Garvey, who is Garvey's second wife, and it's called The Veiled Garvey, produced by a sister from the United States. Her name is Eula Yvette Taylor. I got it online through Brother Pepper Pie, actually told me about it, and I went online and bought a copy. I don't think it's available here in the UK, but I mean, you know, anything can go anywhere now in the world, so you can get that online. Now, this book is the key to Garvey and Garveyism, and this was written by Amy Jakes Garvey. She wrote it in the late 50s, but was unable to find any money to have it published. And in 1962, she was able to borrow some money from two UNIA members in the United States, and so she produced the book Garvey and Garveyism. And it is a chronology of Garvey's work and the importance of that work throughout the different parts of the world. It also highlights their life together and their family life, and it also highlights those who, as you heard in the DVD that was playing, launched that vicious campaign, the Garvey Must Go campaign, and some of the letters that were actually written by our own people to the United States government and other governments reproduced in this. Now, this book, I'll tell you just briefly, was out of print for over 20 or more years. And in 2014 was the 100-year anniversary of the launch of the UNIA ACL. And so the Black Classic Press in Baltimore reproduced the book Garvey and Garveyism. So now we have the good fortune to have it at our disposal. And I have to just blow my own trumpet. I personally imported 36 copies when it was first produced, which people were snapping them up like nobody's business. So I really was selling them just at the price that I paid for them in the postage. But people were really keen. And I believe Brother Pepperkind now has copies of it in his library. So I would highly recommend that copy to you. So let's move on now. I'm going to start my presentation with a poem written by myself, because in the book there's also some of my own personal work. And it's a poem that I wrote a few years back, and it's called The Incomparable Black Woman. Is there any other race of people on this planet who can expect such a leadership, dedication and strength from their women? Black people have much to thank black women for. Black women, the strong, confident ones, the quiet, unassuming ones, the women who are always there for the race, the women who are always there working hard, giving their all, being mother and sometimes father, being everything to our community. The black woman, mother of creation, strong, oh so strong black woman. What is so very sad is that many men fear her strength, fear her strong spirit, and fail to love, honor, and protect her. The black woman, mother, daughter, wife, sister, aunt, grandmother. Black woman, mother of all creation. Black woman, the original guardian angel. Now we'll start, I just share a few bits with you about what people have said about Amy Jakes Garvey. Now, in my view, Amy Jakes Garvey should be considered as one of the great contributors to the liberation fight of African people. Through her work in the Garvey movement, her contribution to the continuance and maintenance of the Garvey legacy, as well as her own personal literary contributions, she is a staunch example of what is needed to become a Pan-Africanist freedom fighter. Her contribution to the liberation of our people is exemplary and acts as a standard. That is what identifies her as a warrior woman. It is also because of this work that she was honored in December 1971 with the Gold Musgrave Medal in Jamaica. And she was the 10th person in Jamaica and only the second woman to receive such a high honor. And that was given to her because of her, her persistent work to push forward Garvey and Garveyism within the society, but also her own Pan-African work, because she subsequently went on to co-work with a number of leading Pan-Africanists to try and create an ideology where we, as a people, look towards self-development, self-reliance, and also to building a nation that would support the needs that were identified for us as a people. And she tells us that the masses need intelligent, dedicated leadership from women. Women don't want to jostle men for jobs. They want what they merit, and to which they can contribute their God-given qualities in trying to liberate this civilization from greed and hate. Now, there's also an article called The Black Scholar that I read. It was written in May to June 1979 by a brother called Mark Matthews. And he tells us that Amy Jakes Garvey is one of the most remarkable women in black history. Professor Tony Martin says that she deserves a substantial study in her own right because she was a leader of the Garvey movement and put her administrative and speaking and literary skills at the disposal of the UNIA ACL. Now, there's a sister called Karen Adler who describes Amy Jakes Garvey as a daunting intellectual orator. And she states that Amy Jakes Garvey was an extraordinary woman. One can only assume that she had profound impact on the lives of many men and women during her lifetime. Because we still have so much to learn from Ellie Jakes today, it is incumbent upon us to bring her life and work back into circulation. We must create for Ellie Jakes Garvey the same legacy that she so vigorously built for her husband, Marcus Garvey. Now, Ellie Jakes was born on the 31st of December, 1896, in Kingston, Jamaica, to Charlotte and George Jakes. She was the eldest of seven children. Amy's family came from what we would call the property class in Jamaican society. Her grandmother on her mother's side was what we call in Jamaica very light-skinned St. Elizabethan people, and her father was a white Scottish farmer. This, not Amy Jakes' father, but her mother's father was a white Scottish farmer who had land in Jamaica. And so this was the kind of society that she came from. She attended Woolmer's High School and subsequently went on to work for a law firm in Kingston before traveling to the United States of America between 1917 and 1918. And the reason she traveled at that time out of Jamaica was that during her work life, she was suffering repeated bouts of malaria. And so her doctor had advised her to try a less tropical climate. And so she decided to do that. Just going back to her early years, she was encouraged by her father to take an interest in world affairs, to read periodicals and the newspaper, and not only just to read it, but to take a keen interest in what was going on in the world. And obviously these factors would shape her for the future life that she was to have. In the book, The Veiled Garvey, Miss Taylor suggests that neither of her parents at the time, they were socializing Amy in this manner. Because it's also said in the documentation that her father had wanted a son for his first child. And as a result of that, he actually brought her up in a similar way that he would have brought up a son. And she was a very keen sponge. She soaked up all of this, this training. She says that he used to, when she was able to walk, he would put her on his shoulders and walk around. He, just so that you know, he had 7 acres of land in, I don't know how many of you are from Jamaica, but it's an area called Mountain View Avenue, and it's at the top end of Kingston, near the, the arena sports center. And it's not such a classy area as it would have been in that time now, because in recent times there's been a lot of uprisings in the area and a lot of police curfew in that area. But he had 7 acres of land there, built the family home there, and they lived there. And he also had 5 other properties in Kingston, which was used when he passed away to look after the family. So she comes from a family that had prepared her for a life in the world, and she was able to use that training for the growth and development of the UNIA. So Miss Taylor suggests that neither parent could have anticipated that she would ultimately be transfigured after living in the United States from a typical debutante in Jamaica society to a disciplined Pan-African thinker, which is what she became. Now, Ellie Jakes is recorded as saying that her father trained her in the tradition befitting a male child. She was exposed to international affairs, but also to male responsibilities of handling field hands and sternly keeping the property clear of stray animals. She records that she was brought up like a boy. There is also documentation to show that she had some issues about race when she was a young girl. And she says that as a child, she didn't like it when her father came to her school because he was very dark-skinned and she was embarrassed by his color. Now, little did she know that she would be catapulted into a woman, committed to a race-first position, join a race-first organization, the UNIA ACL, marry a very black man, Marcus Garvey, and herself become an ardent Pan-African nationalist of her era. So she certainly broke the chains and images of psychological slavery, as identified in the book by Dr. Naim Akbar, who has a book of a similar name. Now, Emmy Jakes meets Marcus Garvey. As I've said already, she traveled to the United States. And another reason she traveled to the United States was at the time when Amy was traveling, which would have been about late 1917, 1918, she was traveling to visit her cousin. But at the time, the war was going on in England because her father had wanted her to become a nurse, and she was to come to England to train as a nurse. But the war meant that single women, I mean, at the time that we're speaking of, single women were hardly allowed out of the sight of their parents or their husbands anyway, because you're talking about a time when women were campaigning for women's rights, and Amy Jakes and a number of the women in the Garvey organization were part of that liberation struggle that was going on. But she went to the United States because she wasn't allowed to travel to England. No ship could take her through the war-torn areas to England. And so on arrival in the United States, she had heard about the meetings at Liberty Hall and the work that the Garvey organization, the UNIA ACL, was doing in America. And she says that she visited the organization, and I'm just going to read you a little bit from page 39, what she has to say about her meeting with Marcus Garvey. She says basically that she had heard conflicting reports about the organization. And so after listening to Garvey's flamboyant oratory, because we know Marcus Garvey was a great speaker, she said that she had quite a lot of questions that she wanted answered. And so she says this: there were many points he did not cover in his speech. On these, I questioned him for the answers. As I told him, I not only wanted to be convinced that he was right, but to be able to argue on my own conviction. His answers seemed to call forth more questions, so an appointment was made, and he was going to show her around the place. So she said that she kept the appointment. Garvey convinced me of the worthiness of his program and stressed the fact that the skin color class system of Jamaica did not exist in America. All people who were of the African race were considered Africans. As you know, many of you may have heard of the one drop rule, which operated in the United States of America, where if you even had only one drop, not that you can measure a drop of blood, I don't know how they managed to do that, but anyway, that one drop meant that you belonged to the African nation, whether you thought so or not, you did. And Garvey was telling her that the better educated had a responsibility to work on behalf of the less educated and create a strong uplift and onward movement. And she goes on to say that he showed her around the office, and there was a number of problems, because Garvey at the time and the UNIA only employed people of African origin in the organization. And as she was saying, there were documents all over the place, letters remained unanswered, things remained unfiled, because a lot of the people who they brought into the organization had no skills, no training. So they then had to get into a position to train them so that they were ready and able to take on this work. And it was as a result of that that she became the Secretary General of the UNIA, and obviously created filing systems, because when she had worked at the law firm in Kingston, she had actually been an administrator. And there she had learnt administrative skills, but she'd also learnt a lot about legal matters, which subsequently, when Garvey was arrested, she was able to use to their benefit. So I've told you how she met Garvey, and she agreed to take on this responsibility. Now, Amy Jakes was a great support for Garvey, and she was also an excellent public speaker in her own right. Garvey asked Amy to write a page for the Negro World newspaper, and not only was she a regular contributor to the Negro World newspaper. Now, for those of you who don't know, the Negro World newspaper was the mouthpiece of the organization, and it was where all matters concerning the organisation was produced. It was circulated widely around the world, and at one point in history, you could be killed or imprisoned for being caught with a copy of the Negro World newspaper anywhere on your persons. And sailors used to hide it and take it around the world with them, and people would congregate in meetings and share the information from this amazing newspaper that was trying to mobilize people so that Africans would see their destiny as one and the same wherever in the world they were. So not only did she write for the newspaper, she often had the task of reading newspapers and magazines on behalf of Garvey, and she describes this as follows. He had no time to read through newspapers and magazines. This was one of my many assignments. I used to cut out clippings, date and identify them, underline significant statements and pin on my comments. Whenever I thought his mind was clear and receptive, I gave them to him. Quite often he handed them back to me saying, tell me what they are about, settling himself into an armchair or getting into bed if the time was after a night's meeting. And you can imagine, I don't know how many of you have read any real works on Garvey, like Race First, Marcus Garvey Hero, etc., etc. There's a whole range of whole heap of books on the life of Marcus Garvey. But, you know, he worked unceasingly. You know, even, I'm going to come on to that, but I just mention it as it's in my mouth at this moment. When he got married to Amy Ashwood Garvey, he had a working honeymoon. Amy Jakes actually traveled with them on their honeymoon because they were going to do UNIA work. You know, it wasn't sitting on the beach enjoying themselves. They were going to do work. So you can see that he must have been very tired after a night's meeting. And so here was someone who was willing to be there to support and to share in that work. You know, so this is why I think it's really important for us and our children to begin to understand these people and the contributions and sacrifices. I mean, she in particular made tremendous sacrifices, because for most of you, anybody who comes from Jamaica knows, when you come from that kind of class background, they're literally done with you once you moved out of that kind of lifestyle then, and it isn't easy for you. I mean, in one of the books, I think it's this book, she describes how after she had returned to Jamaica, this is after Garvey was deported, and subsequently in 1930 they had their first child, which was Marcus Garvey Jr., and then 1933 she had Julius Garvey, the second child, and she said she was pushing him in a pram in, I think it was Kingston, and she met an old-time school friend, and the first thing the woman said to her after she greeted her was, what are you doing with that little black baby? So, you know, all of these kind of things that she must have had to experience when she was in Jamaica, and etc., etc. I'll move on. Now, Amy Jakes and Marcus Garvey were married in July 1922, following the breakdown of his first marriage to Amy Ashwood Garvey. And I've already mentioned to you that they have two sons. Now, Julius Garvey is a medical doctor and resides in the United States of America. And Marcus Garvey Jr., I believe, is an engineer and also lives in America. And Marcus Garvey Jr. was part of the UNIA in the United States of America and was one of the presidents of the organization at some point in his life. Now, the documentation will show that she raised the two Garvey children almost single-handedly. Now, that was principally because in 1935, Garvey came back to England and never returned to Jamaica, because he actually died here on the 10th of June 1940. So all of that, they were very young children at that time, all of that responsibility obviously then fell onto her shoulders. Now, the other thing that is of note at this point in life is that she was only married to Garvey 18 months before he was arrested on the trumped up charges of mail fraud, which when we read all of the documentation and listen to the various tapes and things, we can see was a criminal act on behalf of the United States government and other governments around the world, and also some of our own people, to destroy Garvey's work and to discredit Garvey in whatever way they could, because they really, and Jakes Garvey talks about it in this book, that they really had absolutely no evidence of any such thing, but you know that these people can create whatever they want to create when they want to create it. So during the trial in 1923 was when Mrs. Garvey began to come into her own, and the media focused attention on her, and she is said to have proved her mettle and was described as an able, strong-minded woman, equipped in every way to do good work for the nationalist movement and strengthen the bonds of unity between members of the UNIA. And she showed her intrinsic worth at this time in the cause of African liberation. Now, whilst all of that was being said about her in the media, she actually was not a very well woman. She comes across as strong, but throughout her life, she suffered from a number of unidentified illnesses. And despite this, she went on to, as I've said, do a great work in the UNIA. And I just want to share a short bit from page 56 about her health, just to show you the mettle, page 56, of this woman. I mean, you think of it in today's times, you know, people have a little headache and that's the end of it, they can't do nothing. It says on page 56, Jakes Garvey's intense effort on behalf of her husband and the UNIA took their toll on her physical health. And by August 1924, she was quite ill. At the annual convention, Garvey explained the hardship that they were experiencing. It is no wonder that I have now a sick and half-dying wife because of the suffering that we have had to undergo. And, you know, it goes on to show that despite all of this illness, you know, she rallied, because at this time Garvey was imprisoned in the Tombs Prison in Atlanta, Georgia, and she had to start a fundraising campaign across the United States to raise money for his legal defense, which she did, and she didn't shirk her responsibility. Now, the other thing that's important at this time is how she began to mobilize and to develop a clear understanding of the use of propaganda and the media for trying to create a new way of thinking amongst our people. And whilst Garvey was out on bail in 1923, she describes the fact that they went on a tour of the West Coast of the United States of America. They actually toured 13 states. And she highlighted that this time, the social, economic, and housing conditions, and this was due to the fact that she wanted our people to see the injustices that they were suffering. Because often, if you don't live near people, you're probably thinking, oh, they're much better off over there than us. So a lot of this was documented and featured in the Negro World newspaper. And she talks about the conditions facing our people. She highlighted the social, economic, and housing condition with the aim of exposing the injustices being suffered. She wanted to create a collective black consciousness amongst our people so that they would begin to see the work of the UNIA and ACL as an answer to their problems, and for them to be aware of, you know, the work that was being done to destroy them by the Ku Klux Klan and places like that. And she talks about the Ku Klux Klan at that time as being the spirit of America. Well, we're seeing that spirit waking up now again in this racist piece of person they've got there as the president. And you see, once one start, it won't take long before everybody has jump on board and want to follow. So, you know, we're looking at at least 110 years ago, that she was trying to raise this consciousness in our people. And you know, what is sad for me is that we're still here talking, the same talk. So sometimes you sit and you wonder, well, what is it that prevents people from seeing if she saw them and this information is available to everybody, why are we not looking? So these are some of the things that we need to be thinking about. Let's just move on a bit to Amy Jakes and women's rights. Now, in Amy Jakes' lifetime, the women's suffrage movement was championing the cause for women's rights, and numerous black women were active participants in promoting the need for women's rights. And I want us just to remember that as recent as the 1980s, women were not allowed to purchase property in their own right. Women could not secure a loan unless they had a male guarantor. Women were not allowed to do many things without permission from either their father or their husband. So we're not talking about centuries ago, but obviously when Amy Jakes and people like Madame Demina and Henrietta Vinton Davis, these are all leading women in the Garvey organization, when they were alive, they had no such rights. So it was a very difficult time for them. Now, Amy herself became a strong advocate for the rights of women, as documented in many of her essays featured in the women's page of the Negro World newspaper. And now her page in the Negro World newspaper was entitled Our Women and What They Think. And she constantly encouraged women to step forward and take up their responsibility within the community to initiate and lead on work that was going to advance the growth and development of our people. Now the rights of women were given great priority in the UNIA because each branch had not just a male president, but it also had a female president. There were also female-only organizations. There was an African Women's Motor Corps where women were trained to fight in the same way that men were trained to fight. There was the Black Cross Nurses, which is at the top of the poster of women in the Garvey movement. Now, the Black Cross Nurses was a massive social care network of social care nurses who provided services in the community. And at the 1922 convention in America, it was stated that their membership was over 10 miles long, because when they had these conventions, they had long marches and demonstrations in the area. So you can imagine how long that must have been, you know. Moving on. Now, at the UNIA convention in 1922, lady delegates demanded that women be placed in important positions within the organization to help refine and mold public sentiments. Women demanded absolute control over the UNIA auxiliaries. The auxiliaries were the younger people within the movement. They had something similar to the Girls' Guide and things for young women in the UNIA. I've mentioned the Black Cross Nurses already. And women demanded the freedom to function without restrictions within the organization. Now, in Jakes Garvey's essay, and as I've said, there's many, many essays. I mean, she wrote prolifically, you know. There's one essay which is featured in a book called Daughters of Africa by Margaret Busby, and it's also in my book. And I'm going to just share a little bit from the Black Scholar regarding that essay, where she talks about the strength and dedication given to the Black movement by women. And she unceasingly encourages us to step forward to use our God-given talents to advance the liberation of our people and to change the conditions in the world. Now, she has this to say in her essay, Women as Leaders, and it was written on October 24, 1925. Be not discouraged, Black women of the race, but push forward regardless of the lack of appreciation shown you. A race must be saved, a country must be redeemed, and unless you strengthen the leadership of facilitating Negro men, we will remain marking time until the yellow race gains the leadership of the world and we be forced to subserviency under them or extermination. We are tired of hearing Negro men say there is a better day coming while they do nothing to usher in the day. We are becoming so impatient that we are getting in the front ranks and serve notice to the world that we will brush aside the haughtily cowardly Negro leaders, and with prayer on our lips and arms prepared for any fray, we will press on and on until victory is ours. Africa must be for Africans, and Negroes everywhere must be independent, God being our helper and guide. Mr. Black Man, watch your step. Ethiopia's queens will reign again, and her Amazons protect her shores and people. Strengthen your shaking knees and move forward, or we'll displace you and lead on to victory and to glory. So that's the kind of caliber of woman. She really had a passion for wanting us to have our freedom and for us to be a self-determining people. And she was one of the people who was not just willing to speak to it, but she was willing to jump in there and, as you can hear, get into the battle and get the thing done. Now, in addition to her work around women, Mrs. Garvey wrote many, many other documents. I'll just see if I can remember some of them. Now, she authored a number of books, which we haven't got, which is also a shame that we don't have books like that. She wrote one of the books on Black Power and the way in which Garvey's legacy and influenced Black Power in the United States of America and across the different regions in the world, and it would be really good to see that. I've mentioned already that she published Philosophy and Opinions of Marcus Garvey, Volumes 1 and 2. She actually published that whilst Garvey was in prison because she wanted the world to have a clear understanding of what it was that Garvey was trying to do, what the work was and the program of the UNIA ACL. And she, in addition to fundraising for Garvey's legal defense, she used her own private means to publish the book and to have it circulated around the world, sent to libraries, to counselors within the government, etc. And, you know, this is all hard work. And as I've said, she also subsequently put together Volume 3 of Philosophy and Opinion, which was later published by Professor Hezien Udu of Nigeria, and she was credited with that work. And I've just made a note here that it's important for us to understand how difficult it must have been for Jakes Garvey to complete all the tasks that we hear about. She was not independently wealthy, apart from some family support. Nearly all that she accomplished was due to her own sterling efforts to raise funds to support her work and to support Garvey's work. Now, Jakes Garvey was also subsequently the editorial consultant to a magazine called The African, which was published in Harlem during the 1940s. Again in the 1940s, she formed the African Study Circle in Jamaica. She wrote the collection of essays, which I mentioned already, on Black Power. That was in 1968. It was titled Black Power in America, The Power of the Human Spirit. She also co-worked with a number of leading Pan-Africanists of the day to contribute to the 5th Pan-African Congress that was held in Manchester in 1945. But unfortunately, she wasn't able to attend that Congress at all because she had no money to do so. Now, N. Jakes believed that as long as Africans on the continent were exploited, so would Africans in the diaspora suffer. And she wrote a number of articles. There's one article called the Memorandum Correlative. Now, I've never actually seen this document, and it would really, it sounds like a really interesting document. On page 154 of The Veiled Garvey, they talk about this. She brought together all the, as many of the leading Pan-Africanists of the time as she could contact. She even contacted who we consider to be an enemy of Marcus Garvey, W.B. Du Bois, who was one of the main protagonists in the Garvey Must Go campaign in the United States of America. But by the 60s, she had obviously, she saw the importance of our unity as a people, because a lot of the liberation fights were going on at that time to free Africa and the Caribbean from colonial exploitation and oppression. So a lot of her work around that time was aimed at getting us to think collectively and to try to come together as a people to advance the cause of African freedom. And so this memorandum was to go to the United Nations, and she called upon a number of the leaders in Africa and the West Indies to write this document, and it was to be shared collectively to act as a, it was to be a champion, if you like, to the United Nations, because at that time, Europe was getting all kinds of freedom following the end of the war, and so she wanted that same freedom for her own people. As I say, I don't have a copy of the document. I don't know if anybody's ever even seen it, but that's something that it would be really interesting to see. She also worked, I don't know if many of you have heard of Dr. Harold Moody, who had an organization in Peckham. He was also one of the people who she contacted regarding the memorandum. It's called a memorandum correlative of African rights and freedom. Now, Amy Jakes believed, I think I've said this already, but she believed strongly that as long as Africans on the continent were exploited, so would Africans in the diaspora suffer. And Mrs. Garvey was not just a wife and mother, she was a leader, a journalist, a feminist. She was also a radical nationalist who believed uncompromisingly in the rights of her people to be free of colonialism, to be free of racism and any form of oppression, exploitation and domination. And we see this highlighted in her essay, 1926, The World Today, and that's on page 35 of my book, Women in the Garvey Movement. And Mrs. Garvey points out to our people the need to wake up to what is going on in the world and to ensure that they are making plans for their survival and preparing counter moves in readiness to protect themselves against those who would oppress us. And she said, oppressed people everywhere continue mobilizing to come into their own. And it behoves, she says, Negroes, and we say Africans, but obviously we're looking at that time in history. It behoves Negroes, scattered as we are in different parts of the world, to know the political moves in all countries so that we can make our counter moves for our own safety. Hence, the knowledge of international affairs is a necessity to those who lead the Universal Negro Improvement Association. In addition, I just want to also just look at her life in the 1940s when she was living in Jamaica. You've already heard that she formed an African People's Circle. She also worked with the Norman Manley government at the time. And she says that the aim of that work was to ensure that they didn't bamboozle the masses of the grassroots people. And subsequently, when that government tried to offer her a pension, a widow's pension based on Garvey being the first national hero of Jamaica, she refused it and told them that she had tolerated a lot of suffering in her life and she wouldn't accept this pension because in accepting it, it would be to sell out the masses of the people. So you can see that, and she probably needed that pension because we're looking at in the latter part of her life. But you see, when somebody is principled, you know, they don't just go against their principle because, as we would say in Jamaica, they're licky-licky. She wasn't licky-licky. Mm-hmm. She wanted the best for everyone and not just for herself. Now, let me move on. Other works that she contributed was she aided and contributed financial assistance to the workers' movement in Nigeria. She was instrumental, as I've mentioned earlier, in helping to organize the Pan-African Congress held in Manchester. She was invited to visit Nigeria as the guest of Dr. Nnamdi Azikiwe, who was installed as the first Governor General of Nigeria. And subsequently, she was also invited to Ghana to visit Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. Now, the reason she was visiting these people is because they were very much influenced by Garvey's work. Nkrumah had read Garvey's works and was very interested in that. And Namdi is a Kiwi, had found somewhere, I don't know where, a copy of the Negro World newspaper and was inspired again by Garvey's work. So you can see that her work, as well as the legacy that she was preserving for Garvey, was traveling internationally. And we must remember that the Negro, the UNIA had branches all over the black world. And at its height, it had over 6 million members, half of whom were women, according to the various documentation that's out there. So we can see that, you know, this is a person who dedicated her life to ensuring that our people would be free and to being an active contributor to that. I've mentioned that she worked with the People's National Parties, and she was also helping to sponsor the 6th Pan-African Congress, which was to have been held in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania in 1974, but she died before that would be completed. Now, she died as a freedom fighter on the 25th of July, 1973 in Jamaica. Her work and memory serves the cause for which she dedicated her life as a Pan-African patriot, a pioneering nationalist, political scientist, organizer, journalist, editor, publisher, philosopher, mother, wife, and an immortal African giant. Mrs. Garvey will live forever for black people the world over in their hearts and minds. And I'm gonna just share a couple of other bits with you. I want to share one of her essays just so that you can get a flavor of the activism of this sister. And hopefully it will inspire, you know, I've done a bit of the work, but there's more work to be done to highlight her legacy that other people can do. And it doesn't have to be women that does that work. Anybody can do the work highlighting a great legacy. Now, this particular essay I want to share because she says, the Negro race needs trained men and women, and that was written on the 3rd of July, 1926. And you see if we're not still in need of that same inspiration. To express the belief that the Negro race needs trained men may cause some of our short-sighted critics to view our statement with disapprobation, because many persons of color are prone to consider the race as being limited to America, without taking thought of the teeming millions in Africa and elsewhere. But to us, there are 4 million in the world whose destiny and future are one, whose suffering are identical, and who are now making common cause to alleviate such suffering and to lift the entire race to a plane of honor and respect. Trained men and women are like red corpuscles in the body, the sign of good health. Our race is anemic for lack of this material to give it vim and vigor, to move it along the road of progress. Therefore, it is not keeping abreast of the yellow and white races, but lingering and weak. It depends on the support it gets from others. No one has ever become independent and respected by being a beggar. Nor can one become powerful and strong by depending on the charity of others. As of persons, so of nations and races. We achieve greatness and wealth in proportion to the training we give our minds and bodies and the manner in which we apply ourselves to the exigencies of the hour. So you can see, she's well aware of the problems that we're experiencing and wanting to mobilize us for ourselves. Now, I'm going to share the other essay, which is on the value of propaganda. And this essay was written on the 6th of March, 1927 and was featured in the Negro World newspaper. The value of propaganda. The Associated Press reports from Berlin that 5 million will be spent for propaganda this year by the German government. This is a wise move, actuated perhaps by the bitter experiences of the war 1914 to 1918, when Germany was defeated mainly by Allied propaganda. The horrible tales of atrocities in Birmingham stirred the white world to a united effort to save civilization from Teutonic barbarians, as nothing else could have done. No one stopped to ascertain the truthfulness or source of these stories. Everyone was too high-strung to reason. Why, theirs was but to do or die with the feeling of saving the world for democracy. If we could tell how much England spends on propaganda, many of our readers would be surprised, as it is a very large figure. But it should be remembered that England controls her colonies and bluffs the world by reason of her studied and systematic propaganda. So that doesn't change. Disseminated in such a subtle manner that it is digested without the victim being aware of its poison. Marcus Garvey has been called one of the greatest propagandists of his age because he is one of the few men that saw the great worth of propaganda in the year 1917 and started to use it in its efforts to educate black people to see the necessity for African nationalism and to get white men to appreciate the righteousness of this cause. And then she just goes on to talk about how hard it is to get our people to recognize the value of using propaganda for their own benefits. Now, the last thing I want to share with you is about her passing. These are just some documents that I picked up in Kingston at the Institute of Jamaica. They were placed in the National Library, which is in downtown Kingston. And the first one is about when she passed. The University of the West Indies undergraduates called on the nation to make her a national heroine. They also called for the government to give her a state funeral and to have her remains laid next to Marcus Garvey in National Heroes Circle in downtown Kingston. They also wanted the University of the West Indies Guild to offer her a posthumous honorary degree. And that was because of her work across Jamaica. She gave lectures, she gave interviews with all kinds of scholars from all over the world on Garvey and his life and legacy. So, you know, it's interesting that we read so many books and we've hardly ever seen this kind of commitment documented. So it really is important that we value that dedication and that struggle. And the other thing to say is that I know that the students of CAST also named their Hall of Residence in honour of Amy Jakes Garvey. And the Parliament had a minute's silence to acknowledge her passing. And she passed away on the 25th of July. 1973 in this area of Kingston. So thank you very much.
You talked about how the students at the University of West Indies requested for her to be buried next to her husband at the
National Heroes Park in Kingston.
Did that happen?
No, it didn't happen. Oh, look, it was Dickens to get Garvey home. I mean, it took years to get Garvey's body to be relocated to Jamaica from here in England. And in fact, I mean, this I don't know if it's true or lie, but I was told that it was only because Ghana had planned to give Garvey some great honour why Edward Seaga rushed forward for the country to claim Garvey's body and bring it home and for them to make him a national hero. And in fact, I've seen today on the internet where the current government under Babsy Grange, the Minister of Culture, they are they're putting a motion into the Parliament to wipe away all those terrible things that they did to Garvey and to exonerate him from all the charges that they made against him. All that imprisonment that they imprisoned him and all of that. And so that will be going to the Parliament. I understand also that I didn't have time to read it this morning because I had to go out and then I had to come straight here. by the time I got back, but there is also something about one of the African countries this week naming a road to honour Marcus Garvey and his work. So you can see the far-reaching arms that Garvey is, reaching even today. Now, it's still so relevant to our lives as a people. We won't necessarily do things exactly how Garvey did it, but we've got that blueprint to look at to guide the work that we want to carry forward.
What about the other suggestions that you had that you listed? So it was to bury her with her husband, to what else?
None of it came into being. Apart from the students, obviously they had the authority to name their hall of residence, which they did. But in my book here, we wrote to the Jamaica government. Some years ago, we had a couple of women's group, the Universal African People's Development Association. We actually wrote two letters to PJ Patterson about naming her as a not just her, but her and Amy Ashwood Garvey, because these are women who have made a tremendous contribution to our history and to world history. If you go to 1 Bassett Road in near Labrook Road Library, you will see the blue plaque dedicated to Amy Ashwood Garvey. There's a place in Carnaby Street where she had a restaurant and social club and all sorts of things. She was an active social worker in this country, working on behalf of, she worked with Claudia Jones in Ladbroke Grove. When they had the race riots after they murdered Kelso Cochrane, they were the people who were got together to organize documentation around why these things were happening and to put forward proposals for helping to cool down the racial tension. So,
that's really sad.
Absolutely. But that also is about us.
You're not asking England all of this, you're asking where he was born.
Well,
where
she was Frederick Douglass says, power concedes nothing without demand. If we don't demand, nobody's going to just come and give us. So, it's a bit like reparations. Look, if every single one of us were mobilising, wherever we are, around all of these issues, we would get where we're going, but all too often, it's a little handful of people. And then just brush us aside, like saying important.
Thank you for enlightening me about Amy, because I don't want most people to have nothing much about this or about laughing.
Okay.
And I do appreciate it. And I just wanted to ask you why she hasn't given the recognition that she deserves. Is it because she's a woman or what she stands for?
I think largely because I think the focus has been on Garvey and on, a lot of injustice was done to Garvey in his lifetime. So I think a lot of the focus has been on highlighting the big sacrifices that he made for advancing us as a people. I think now people are more aware of all of that work. They're looking at other people who were there as well. So that's where I think you're now beginning to get people looking at, because in fact, in this book, Marcus Garvey Jr. talks about how women were the backbone of the organisation, and without them. And I mean, this is all documented. It's not that we're coming now to fabricate this.
No, it's happening.
It's there.
Yeah.
At least 60% of the organisation were women. And they mobilised, they made the clothes for the Black Cross nurses, for all of the auxiliaries and the different groups within the fundraising. The restaurant was run by a young woman, Mary Lawrence. The printing press at one time was run by a young lady called Lillian Galloway. You had people like Madame Demina, Marie du Chatelier, Henrietta Vinton Davis, all international organizers. They went around internationally recruiting members for the organisation. Amy Ashwood was a director of the Black Star Line Shipping Corporation, the ships that, Garvey had bought, as was Madame Demina and a number of other women. And there are also many, many women who we know nothing of. Mm. You know, we don't even know their names.